Wisdom, the final frontier to true knowledge. Welcome to Wisdom Trek, where our mission is to create a legacy of wisdom, to seek out discernment and insights, to boldly grow where few have chosen to grow before. Hello, my friend. I am Guthrie Chamberlain, your captain on our journey to increase wisdom and create a living legacy. Thank you for joining us today as we explore wisdom on our second millennium of podcast. This is day 1466 of our trek, and it is Worldview Wednesday. Creating a biblical worldview is essential to have a proper perspective on today's current events. To establish a biblical worldview, you must have a proper understanding of God and His Word. This week on a Worldview Wednesday episode, we will continue with our study based on a course I recently completed, taught by Dr. Michael Heiser. Our study is titled, Sons and Daughters of God, The Believer's Identity, Calling, and Destiny. Throughout this multi-week course, we will demonstrate in the Old Testament that the sons of God and the Holy Ones refers to supernatural beings whose Father is God and who work with God to carry out His will, and that His divine family was present before humanity. By fully engaging the biblical texts, such as Psalm 82, Psalm 89, and Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 8 and 9, our study will show that this divine family functions as a template for God's human family. God desires of human, as His imagers, to participate in His counsel. This study addresses issues such as polytheism and the nature of little g gods and the uniqueness of Yahweh. Within this study, we will apply insights to the New Testament text and shows how the metaphor of being in God's family informs our sense of identity and mission as believers. So today we want to look at Elohim and the Divine Council. And segment 14 is, Who is or are the Elohim? Part 1. We want to first look at that Elohim does refer to the God of Israel, but also to other gods. So how do biblical writers use the term Elohim? Well, the most apparent referent is to the God of Israel. You recall in Psalm 82 that the word Elohim occurred twice. The first one was undoubtedly singular and, of course, pointing to the God of Israel, later called the Most High in verse 6. But in Psalm 82 verse 1, we also had the plural Elohim of Yahweh's counsel. God takes a stand in the divine assembly in the midst of the gods. In the midst of the Elohim, He passes judgment. So, the God of Israel, the gods of the divine council, Elohim, is used to refer to the gods of the various nations. For instance, in 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 33, we have the names of Ashtaroth, Chemosh, and Milcon, which were foreign deities, and they are all referred to with the term Elohim. Now, if Elohim meant to bring a unique set of attributes, the verse right here in 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 33, would sort of explode that idea all by itself. Here we have three different foreign deities. Very obviously, they are not going to have a specific set of attributes that we would attribute to the God of Israel. So attributes aren't wrapped up in the term Elohim. Elohim is connected to territorial spirits. Further, Elohim is used in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17, in juxtaposition with the term Shadim, which most English Bibles translates demons. So these are other entities that are referred to as Elohim. Specifically in this verse, the problem is that the Israelites, who were not sacrificing properly to God, but rendered sacrifices to other Elohim, who are Shadim, or demons. The term actually means territorial spirits or territorial entities. But the point is, of course, that we are not talking about the God of Israel when we refer to Elohim here. And we are not assigning a specific set of unique attributes to Shadim, to these lesser entities. Elohim is also referred to as a disembodied human dead. In 1 Samuel chapter 28, verse 13, Elohim is used to describe the disembodied human dead. This is the medium at Ender's story, and Saul wants to contact Samuel because God won't answer his prayers. In this scene, she does whatever she does, and we're not actually told what she does. She's sort of shocked and dismayed because she sees Samuel, and that's sort of a clue to her that this person asking her to bring up Samuel is probably Saul. What she actually says to Saul is, I see an Elohim coming out of the ground. And then Saul asked her, what does he look like? Again, he is fixated on one, what does he look like? and she describes him. And Saul says, sure enough, you know that's him, that's Samuel. We know from the discussion in the scene that this disembodied spirit of Samuel relates things to Saul that only Samuel would know or that God would have told him before. We also see in another situation, Elohim is referred to the angel of the Lord. And this is found in Genesis chapter 35, verses 1 through 7, and we have a reference to Elohim here. The reference may or may not refer back to either angels generically, or in my view, it probably does not. It probably refers to one specific angel, God in human form, because the episode of Genesis chapter 35, verses 1 through 7, is linked back to something in Jacob's life. Jacob is the person involved in this text, so you could have Elohim here referring to the angel of Yahweh, the angel of the Lord. But when biblical writers wrote about Elohim, they were not thinking about the unique attributes. Regardless of how we identify the last one specifically, whether it was the angel of the Lord, the angel of Yahweh, what we have here is a collection of different entities, all of which are described with one word, all of which described with the word Elohim. Only one of them is the God of Israel, at least as we think of him. The angel of the Lord could have been identified as the God of Israel, but the other ones that we've discussed so far are certainly not referring to the God of Israel or Yahweh. And so, this alone tells us that when we have the biblical usage of the term Elohim, when the biblical writer used this word, he was not thinking of a unique, exclusive set of divine attributes. He was not thinking in terms in Hebrew the way that we think of the letters G-O-D, and that's really where the disconnect is. Elohim refers to a member of the supernatural realm. So you might ask at this point, well, okay, if it doesn't mean these other things, what does Elohim mean? If it's not about attributes, what is the point of it? Why would the biblical writer use this term? A biblical writer would use the word Elohim to refer to anything in the spirit world, which is by nature the disembodied realm, the disembodied spiritual world. If you were a member of that world, you would be an Elohim. God is a member of this world. Demons or Shadim are members of this world. The gods of the heavenly council, the angels, the deceased human dead, the disembodied human dead, all of them are members of the same place, the disembodied spiritual world, the supernatural realm. For this reason, I like to describe Elohim as really a term about the residence or realm or even location. It's not about a specific set of unique attributes. You would use the word Elohim to describe some being within this realm. That is where they live. That is where they belong. And that is all Elohim really means. So in the spiritual world, we can have multiple and many Elohim. And this isn't polytheism. That's just the spirit world. It says nothing about any of these entities being equal or interchangeable. And that's really the heart of polytheism. We need to take a little closer look at the thought next. And this is segment number 15, which is part 2 of Who Is or Are Elohim? And first we want to look at how Yahweh is unique. Now we just talked about Elohim being a place of residence term, referring to any entity that is, by definition, a member of the disembodied spirit world. Yahweh, of course, the God of Israel, is a member of that world. He is an inhabitant of the spirit world. I like to put the relationship between him and other him like this. Yahweh, the God of Israel, is an Elohim. He is one of many Elohim, but no other Elohim is him. No other Elohim is Yahweh. Yahweh is, again, and maybe this is an awkward phrase, but I think it's a good one. Yahweh is species unique. There is only one like him. There is only one him. There is no other like him. Yahweh alone is assigned a set of unique qualities. Now, what this means in theological terms, and I think by way of practically understanding these theological terms, is that the Elohim in biblical thinking, even though there are many, they are not equal and interchangeable. Yahweh is in a class by himself. Yahweh is, in fact, distinguished by other means. He is described in ways that no other Elohim are ever described. So biblical writers would assign unique qualities to Yahweh. Things like the God of Israel. Yahweh is all-powerful, for instance, in Jeremiah 32, verse 17 and 27 as well. Yahweh is also referred to as sovereign king and creator. Yahweh gets described as being a sovereign king over other Elohim in Psalm chapter 95, verse 3 and in Daniel chapter 4, verse 35, for example. No other Elohim are ever described in these terms. Yahweh is also described as the creator of the other members of the heavenly host council in Psalm chapter 148, 1 through 5, and Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 6. Even the sonship language sort of telegraphs this idea. He is the originator of all the other ones. It never works the other way around. And only Elohim is to receive worship. Yahweh is the lone Elohim as well, who deserves worship from the other Elohim, Psalm chapter 29, verse 1. The other Elohim are actually commanded to worship the Lord. And we see in Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 6, the uniqueness of Yahweh. And I think this sort of captures a lot of this. It actually says, "You alone are Yahweh." Again, speaking of the God of Israel, "You alone are Yahweh." It's a way in biblical language, biblical terminology of saying, "You, Yahweh, are unique. There is only one of you." And we must understand that multiple Elohim doesn't equal polytheism. So what we have when it comes to divine plurality in the Hebrew Bible, multiple Elohim, it's not referring to polytheism. A biblical writer, someone who was, if we can use these terms, orthodox in his theology, would never think of Yahweh as though other Elohim are on the same level and have the same attributes. That just wasn't even in their mind. Yahweh is alone. He is unique. There is none like him. So this is not polytheism. This is something else. This is what the biblical writers believed. Multiple entities in the spirit world, but only one of this kind. That is what the biblical writers believed. And so we don't need to come up with sort of contrived explanations of what the term Elohim means in Psalm 82 or any other place. We don't have to say things like they were idols or they were people. No, they are just other spiritual beings, and Yahweh is supreme and unique among them. And that will finish our study for this week's Worldview Wednesday. Next week we will study God's proclamation, "None besides me." Tomorrow we will enjoy a 3-minute humor nugget that will provide you with a bit of cheer, which will help you to lighten up and live a rich and satisfying life. So encourage your friends and family to join us. And then come along with us tomorrow for another day of Wisdom Trek, Creating a Legacy. If you'd like to listen to any of the past 1,465 treks or read the Wisdom Journal, they are all available at wisdom-trek.com. And I encourage you to subscribe to Wisdom Trek on your favorite podcast player so that each day's trek will be downloaded to you automatically. And thank you so much for allowing me to be your guide, your mentor. But most importantly, I am your friend as I serve you through the Wisdom Trek podcast and journal each day. And as we take this trek of life together, let us always live abundantly, love unconditionally, listen intentionally, learn continuously, lend to others generously, lead with integrity, and leave a living legacy each day. I am Guthrie Chamberlain, reminding you to keep moving forward, enjoy your journey, and create a great day every day. See you tomorrow.